let's look at the situation in the world, right? First of all, we've got the Gaza atrocities by the Israelis have correctly excited the animosity of the universe, and it started with the four Palestinian kids getting rocketed on a beach as they were playing and others injured. And now overnight we've had 20 people, many children, killed in a United Nations school in Gaza. And this morning, the word in the Washington Post, I won't go through any quotations from this, but we have Michael Oren, the former Israeli ambassador to Washington, who's been working as a spokesman for these atrocities. He says the world has to stand aside while the Israelis crush Hamas. Well, unfortunately, this is faulty political thinking. It's a crime, to be sure, but it's also worse than a crime. It's a mistake. In other words, there is no military way to crush Hamas, and I think this is in bad faith. Hamas was widely reported to be in a crisis of legitimacy some months ago, and the net effect of this current round of atrocities by the Israelis is to shore up Hamas. And naturally, I'm a big critic of Hamas because they were backing Morsi in Egypt. There is good reason to believe that Hamas was at least complicit in sending terrorists into the northern Sinai. So they're not just attacking the Israelis, they attack the Egyptians. And Haniyeh, after having gone to Iran to see Ahmadinejad in the early part of 2012, he then turned around and began attacking Assad of Syria. So Haniyeh is a very fishy character. But we've got to set aside the problems of Hamas, right? We know that this organization was in effect created by Ariel Sharon. It was designed to be a counterweight to split the Palestinians against the PLO. But now we've got to think about all these people, right? So it's about 800 Palestinian dead, and this is now it's going at about 20-1 from the casualties on the Israeli side, approximately 40, and on the Palestinian side, about 800. So 20-1. Still not good for the Israelis, right? In the long run, that's more damaging to them demographically than it is to the Palestinians. But what horrible calculations are these? I would say, obviously, Netanyahu is a madman. Netanyahu cannot be tolerated by the world. We should also remember that the degradation of Israeli politics is to a large degree Netanyahu's handiwork as finance minister, imposing effect shock therapy on a rather, what can we say, well-organized Israeli economy decades ago. We now have this situation where the youth generation of Israel feel they have nowhere to go. We've had those huge demonstrations, no future. So with no future, this kind of demagogy can get going. It is also, as I'll just say in a minute, time to impose a solution. A solution must be imposed on these parties. And we'll be back in a minute. Welcome back to World Crisis Radio. When it comes to the question of a solution, if it turns out now, as it seems, that the two-state solution cannot be negotiated by the principals themselves, it would be the task of the international community, in a real sense, to impose such a solution, and it would go something like this: it's more or less the Geneva Accord of Yossi Beilin and Yasser Abed Rabo from November 2003, which remains the landmark. It's two states, equally sovereign. It means the 1967 borders with agreed on changes. It means that all Israeli settlements must go unless they are agreed to in one of these exchanges, and that the right of return will have to be relativized into indemnities. In other words, people have a right to return in theory, But in practice, the way that's going to be expressed is through indemnities, through large cash payments to them, permitting them to set up a new life where they want. Same thing goes for the Israeli settlers. Those people, many of them poor and desperate, will have to be indemnified. And with that, you'd also have to have then security guarantees for both sides. You'd probably have to have a peacekeeping force strung out along the various borders. And the most important element is the economic reconstruction and development plan, which would have to be also Middle East regional, couldn't just be Israeli because of the nature of it, couldn't be just Israel and Palestine. It would have to be a more general plan, and including all of the war-destroyed areas, be it now Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, the Sinai, you go down the list, all the way down to Somalia. In other words, an entire Middle East economic reconstruction program. And if we had a rational approach to world affairs, this could then be imposed. As it is, it's not clear where we're going. What we do find is that the closing of the airport indicates a serious weakness for the Israelis. And it's actually amazing that that these airlines did not draw these conclusions at an earlier point. Iron Dome, okay, up to a certain point. But if you had somebody like Hamas being joined by Hezbollah, this is an unlikely combination, but just from the technical point of view, if you had these rockets coming in from two directions, or suppose you had them coming in from some part of Syria, right? Suppose there were some group there that decided that they wanted to start sending these rockets in, then that Iron Dome might not look so effective. And one of the scenarios, of course, if the U.S. were ever to attack Iran, one of the obvious things would be to simply keep Israel under continuous rocket fire, obviously now focusing on these airports, and do tremendous damage, right? That's the one of the reasons you don't want to have a general war in the Middle East. So obviously, it's time to have the ceasefire. But the one thing that world public opinion has understood here in this current crisis is that not only is there an occupation, in effect, there's certainly an occupation of the West Bank. It's very oppressive. But then there's also a blockade. In other words, you take this entire Gaza area, make all those people into de facto prisoners, you've got a blockade. And I think world public opinion has understood for the first time, perhaps, that there is a blockade and that also has to end. But if you want to get out of that, you've got not only do you have to convince the Israeli side, you got to convince Egypt. And that's where Haniyeh is an impossible candidate for doing anything. Right? The word was that if you had an election, Hamas would be out on their ear. But that's not the case anymore. Now you've got another 2 or 3 years for Hamas. So this is a terrible situation, and unless and until we get cooperation of the great powers, notably the United States and Russia, would be the ones that would have to do this principally, then this simply goes on and on. So there we go. And the word to all concerned is, if you don't want peace, if you don't want war, negotiate peace and pay the price for peace in terms of concessions. One thing that could push this along, if American public opinion is increasingly horrified by the Israeli atrocities, perhaps now it's time to cut the $3 to $4 billion per year subsidy which the United States pays for this. This would then force Israel to act more as a normal country, that is to say, not having this huge subsidy. They would then have to find concessions and other means to get along, to somehow reach a modus vivendi with their various neighbors. So this is obviously a big element in the world crisis, right? Along with ISIS and everything going on in Syria and elsewhere, and of course Ukraine.